Yeah, family, welcome back to First Frequency of One is Shock Metaphysics. It's me, your beloved Reverend Dr. Philippe Shock Matthews, aka the Metaphysical Morpheus. It's Thursday, and the man with the plan to put the knowledge in your hand, he's here with us, but he had to take a bathroom break real quick. Because when you're a certain age, that's what you have to do. So it doesn't matter when it happens. It's just when it happens, you better go and do what you got to do. That being said, the rumbling that you hear in the background, I believe, is that man with the plan to put the knowledge in your hand, the crazy man himself, family, Dr. Clyde Winters. What's going on, my beloved? How you feeling?
Everything is fine, man. I got a little like melanosynthesis this morning. The sun is shining.
Nice.
You know, I stood outside. I took my shirt off. No people was around. I took my shirt off. So I
bask in the melody. Bask in the glory of Ma'at.
Yes, sir.
You know. Oh, that's nice.
You know, I was trying hard because I said maybe if I stand out there long enough, it'll make my hair grow back. But it didn't help.
It didn't work.
But I was trying.
But that's all you can do. That's all you can do, Doc. Yes, sir. Shout out to Power Inc., Brother Damien. Thank you for tuning in. Katrina Prater back with us and many more. So what's been going on in the last week? A lot has been going on in the last week. Too much for me to even keep up. What's going on in your world? Hey, PJ, I see PJ coming on. Yeah. Excellent, excellent.
Well, it's a lot of stuff. I finally finished up one of my last papers I had to read.
Was it class? Okay.
I know it's been a while, but, it was one one that was real long, so I finally finished that one, so I'm done.
Okay.
I'm done with finishing reading all the papers and, giving suggestions on how it can be done to make it better and stuff, so.
Fantastic.
You know, I know a lot of people probably say, well, hey, Dr. Winters, where's my paper?
Yeah. Well, we had a lot of students. You had a lot of students this last time around, so it was a lot to fulfill. Yeah.
Yeah, I did, you know. Yeah. The thing is this.
Hotep Melinda, Hotep Akil, I see you guys out there.
The thing is this, though. It was good, a lot of good papers, and the thing for the future, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a couple of people, they want to go and go to your old university and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a very informative group. You know, each group is different. But again, you know, it's all part of trying to, rise up. Wow, wow, wow.
Leave Sister Shanice alone. That's her saying. I love her when she does that.
I love it.
I love it.
Family. Yesterday, Reverend Matthews completed his piece on race technology on Sister Shanice's channel. So I hope you guys will go over there and look at it because it's very informative. It'll teach you and it'll help you maybe be able to fight some of that trauma. Maybe to
no doubt
get away from some of that trauma, you know.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Have you? Huh?
No, go ahead.
No. When is your next rant? I know you got to go on Sister Shanice soon. What are you going to be talking about in your next round with Sister Shanice?
She can tell me whatever she want to talk about. I don't care. I don't have anything. I did my series on the history of the Brodinax and all that.
Okay. Okay.
Anything you want to talk about that I can maybe talk about? You know, I don't have anything too much that I'm too excited about. I know I'm on May 27th. I'm going to do a live broadcast on the. On the first aeronautical ace, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm gonna do that on a live broadcast, you know. But other than that, whatever she want me to do, I'll do it, you know.
Absolutely, absolutely. Shout out to Sister Shanice. Yoshi Ma, the genius, is in the audience with us. What's going on, Yosh?
The genius.
The genius himself.
He made that new. He made that new video, the new song, and it's great. You know,
absolutely.
You got to go to Spotify and you got to check out Yoshimad's music, I mean, it's there. I mean, it's the music that's going to change our whole personality, change where we're going. You know, that's one of the things that Reverend Matthews brought up yesterday. And is the fact, in a sense, is that you need memes, and that music is a way that it can really energize a community, energize any type of movement too.
It's kind
of,
you know. Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. Now, this is probably one of the most replete classes you've done, because this is now part three of Aboriginal Foundational Black Americans. Can you give us a brief reminder, summary of what the first two were that you covered, and then what you're going to be covering again today? Sister Shanice. Hey, Sister Shanice, great to see you, fam.
Wow,
she's with us. Wow.
I will steal it.
Me too. Oh, that's great.
It's all that excitement. Okay, part one, I discussed the, the Paleo-Americans. I discussed, in a sense, how Black people have been in America, at least for 34,000 years that we know of archaeologically.
Mm-hmm.
I know the sister, not a sister, but I know this researcher in Brazil, she says that African people have been here for 100,000 years in Brazil.
Mm.
But in America, our evidence usually goes back to about 34,000. I talked about the fact in the first one how many people today that carry the R1 haplogroup, V88, or just R1 generally, that many people today exist in America, at least 22%.
Mm.
20% of the FBA population carries the R1 haplogroup. And what makes that important is that the Paleo-American, you know, Anzique man and Anzique boy, we was the babies, or Anzique boy, and he carried R1. They try to change it to C. It's all bullshit. You know, they change whenever I find out about something, they try to change it. You know, I had wrote a thing in 2016, 2018, something. And I showed all the evidence at Egypt Search that was showing that Anzique man carried R1, and I mentioned the fact that 22% of Afro-Americans carry R1. Do you know they took down every site that said that Anzique man carried R1?
What?
To see, yes, every site.
They took
them down, you know. And but the thing is this, is that it doesn't matter. I had copied a lot of the sites, so I still put it up so I can still go to it. And so then in part two, I did a little bit different. In part two, I talked about, in a sense, the technology. I talked about the fact that Aboriginal Foundation of Black Americans, they built a lot of stone roads. They built stone pyramids. I talked about the fact that the railroads, some of the stone and the dirt that was used to build up the railroads across the Midwest was mainly a result of them tearing down the mounds. I talked about the fact that the Aboriginal Americans at Cahokia had built a tunnel up under the Mississippi River, and they could cross from Illinois, I think it was, into Missouri and Kansas, underground, under the Mississippi River. So that just shows our technological experience. I talked in number two about the various castles. Yeah, the Aboriginal Black Americans built castles. And then I talked a lot about the mounds. I paid a lot of special attention to the mounds that go to the Mississippian period and the Adena mounds, because the Mississippian mounds and the Adena mounds, these mounds, in a sense, have a lot of artifacts that point back to the voyage of Abu Bakari in 1300 AD. But, you know, building mounds along the Mississippi River, it goes back, you know, tens of thousands of years ago. In this one, I'm going to talk about I'm going to talk about the various Aboriginal tribes, their culture, their religion, and I'm going to even talk about the fact is that, you know, a lot of people they like to talk about the fact that that they're not African, even though they're Aboriginal Americans. So I want to talk about I might talk about the fact in the sense is that how many of that the greeting that they use today that they think makes them unique is really a Mandingo greeting.
Oh, wow. This is going to be great.
You know, they don't understand, like, the Mandingo, it was so many Mandi tribes here, so many Mandingo tribes, you know, because when Abubakari came from the Empire of Mali over to the over to the Americas, it was 25,000 people, man. 25,000 people.
Wow.
In this expedition. And, you know, just sometimes I just think about how in ancient times, you know, these people could get armies of 10, 20, yeah. 30, 40,000 people and put them on the field and they kill each other.
It's insane. Yeah.
It's insane, you know, but it's just the organization, you know, just the organization.
And, so this is good. This is good.
Yeah.
So what are you going to be presenting today in your conference? This is what we're going to learn today.
Yeah, probably about the influence on the American language, the various tribes, the religions, and I'm going to explain. I'm going to explain some things that a lot of people have never even thought about, because see, the history of Aboriginal Black people is so extensive. And that's one of the reasons why I had to divide it into three parts, because I thought I was just going to do one. I tried to stop.
I remember that. Yeah.
I tried to stop looking at, looking at information, because then I said, damn, it could go on forever. But, you know, we're not going to, we're not going to meet next week. That's going to be African Liberation Day. So, Reverend Matthews is going to be doing some other things, you know. I may do something too, but I don't know. But the thing is, this is that probably the week I want to do the Black Europeans, you know. I want to talk about the Black people. There was the Jamestown, the Japanese,
yes,
the Jacobites, all that. But it's sometimes when I talk about, you know, the Black Europeans that came over here, it makes me get confused. It's mind boggling. So many people I've been taught was white,
right?
White, and you know, just like I checked on the you know, what's her name, Bartolana, origin of the white race,
Dr. Jacqueline Batalora.
Yeah, Batalora. Yeah, I went and looked at the real laws, and she's completely wrong, and she's completely wrong.
Oh, wow. We're going to have to counter that. Wow. Fascinating. Okay.
They don't say nothing about white people. The first mention of the white man is 1705. And then the main thing about the Bacon's Rebellion. Yeah, Bacon Rebellion, it was a lot of, it was black and white indentured servants. You know, they were fighting together. But that didn't instill the whole idea of the white man. Because, see, even back then, you know, it's very important to understand that the only people that they identified as blacks were from Africa. See, if you were an African and you were called a Negro and you was identified as black, but if you came from Europe, you are identified as white.
Even if you were of African ancestry.
Yeah. Even if you were I'll put it like this, phenotypically African. Because see, they didn't identify with an African ancestry because they said they were either Irish, Scottish, Dane, or German. Even though when you go back in the history, you know that most of the Danes were Moors and stuff. That's why you find the real blondes. That's why they have thick noses, thick lips, and stuff like that. That's because of the fact that most of the Danes were descendants of Moors.
Wow. Yeah. Wow. Incredible.
I'm not going into all that, but I'm going
to. I want you to get into this. This is the PowerPoint I'm ready to see.
Yeah, well,
I am ready to see this lesson. Let me pull it up.
Yeah.
All right. Fantastic. Here we go, fam.
Okay.
There we go.
The Aboriginal Foundation of Black Americans. Today we're going to talk about all the various, Black tribes. Not all the Black tribes, because, you know, just like you go to a city and you try to find Black churches. It's about 1,000 of them on the same block. And that's the way it was with Black Indians. You know, Black people are, for some reason, we always have this thing where we want to be unique. And the way we feel that we can be unique is to start something that only we can be the leader of. You know, it's just like you belong to a Black church. Then somebody in the church will say, hey, I think I can do better than Reverend so-and-so. So I'm going to start my own church down the block. That's the same way they did with tribes. There were so many African tribes, you know, Aboriginal tribes that it's really hard to really jot them all down. And another thing, too, is that when you really try to look at the languages that these various tribes spoke, it's kind of difficult because, see, the way that Second Frequency recorded their languages, they make you think that all the languages were very disunified. Because, see, what you find in a sense is that many other languages, unless you really do really good research on many Aboriginal lands, what happened is that a lot of the broke-ass, you know, Mongoloid Indians came up here from Mexico. And when they came up from Mexico, by the time they migrated to the East Coast, where the 13 colonies, you know, they were in their teepees and they were hunting and all that type of mess. And so many of the Black tribes adopted them. And so when the Europeans would go to an Aboriginal Indian village, they would find, in a sense, the black Aboriginal Indians, and then there would be a town. It would be a little village next to the Black Aboriginal Indians that, in a sense, was really occupied by Mongoloid. You know, Dr. Short, he called me last week, and he was talking. He was trying to say, everybody keeps saying they're Blackfoot in South Carolina and Virginia, and North Carolina. And he said, but when he looked on the computer, the only Blackfeet lived in the Midwest. And I explained to him what happened is that after the Revolutionary War, the government began, in a sense, to assign Mongoloid Indians the names of the Black tribes, and then they set them up in different parts of the country. You know, because I said all the Blackfeet are still there, but the Blackfeet down there in South Carolina, North Carolina, a few in Mississippi. I said mostly all of them, they're considered Negroes or Black. And since they're considered Black, then people try to ignore them. So I said, it's very important you get into this history, you see. Okay, remember to join my Patreon. I want to thank everybody that's been joining my Patreon. Again, my Patreon, that allows me to be able to do the research I do. And also join Reverend Matthews' Patreon. He has a lot of good programs going on in his Patreon. And I do too. I'm going to put my slides in the Patreon, and all of my presentations on any channel, all my presentations on any channel, you're going to find them in my Patreon. Okay, you can go to the Clyde Winters Afrocentric History site. This is my YouTube channel. I want you to go to my YouTube channel and look at some of the videos. I want you to subscribe, you know. I want you to subscribe to the channel. There's some good videos there. You know, my best one is the fight whiteitis. And people need to see that video, you know. Also, I have one on, about why Europeans have an inferiority complex. And I think that you would find those videos very interesting, and also they're informative. So again, visit my YouTube channel. I'm at Twitter, Dr. Clyde Williams 8. You know, I'm on Twitter every now and then, but I don't have that much exciting to talk about, so I'm not on Twitter that much. So you wouldn't be able, in a sense, to really find a lot of messages from me, but sometimes I put out some messages. But again, I don't put out a whole lot because of the fact, in a sense, is that, you know, it's not too many exciting things. You know, maybe if I was going to more parties, or maybe if I was living around Reverend Matthews, maybe I could be involved in a lot more stuff and all that.
Nope. I'm more boring than you are, my brother. I'm just sitting here doing shows and research. That's all I do all day.
Yeah, well, I only
do research. You at least get to go to the casino every now and again, don't you?
I go to my social club.
Your social club. I'm sorry, not casino. I'm sorry.
That's my social club. I communicate with the people, sit around with the rest of the old people. Yes.
Yes. Socialize.
Yeah, but you know, but again, sometimes I go there and I'm very selfish. And I'll go there and I'll see somebody coming in with their wife, you know, holding them up or pushing them in a wheelchair, and I get jealous, you know, because, you know, I'm selfish, you know, I wish I had my wife to kind of push her ass around but then I know that she was very sick. I know that I was happy that she went to be with God, went to the Crystal City, because I know she was out of that pain, but I'm selfish. I still wish I had her, you know. But I mean, hey, that's not fair. It's wrong. It's wrong to be selfish like that. But that's the way men are. Men are very selfish. When we get a good woman, we don't want to let them go, and that's bad. That's bad because we should be prepared to do that. And then, like I was telling my daughter yesterday, they said that men die first. And what am I still doing here? But again, you know, that's life. Also, you can now get my books at Amazon.com. What is FBA? FBA is not a group. FBA is not an organization. FBA is a lineage. A lineage is lineal descent from an ancestor, or pedigree. As a result, we are descendants of the African and Aboriginal Blacks who built the United States. B1 is acknowledging your Black African ancestry in MOD, not heritage. What is B1? B1 is unity with MOD. Dr. Marie Childs has noted that Kim Dijit Ki MOD. Kim Dijit Ki MOD, to be Black, speak you, MOD. You know, always remember that, you know, these are the scholars who really brought up about Blacks in ancient America, the old mix. That's, you know, David Imhotep, the great player, you know, Ivan Van Sertima, and of course, my boring self. Then, remember, in a sense, is that if you want to find out more about Aboriginal Black Americans, not so much everything in this video, because this video, everything in this video is completely, totally new. But you can find out more about the Aboriginal FBA in Black History Gems, Volume 1. It's an essay in there that deals with Aboriginal Indians. But I've been trying, in a sense, to really get myself together so I can write a short piece on the various technological innovations of the Aboriginal Black Americans, because a lot of people they don't understand is that Aboriginal Americans had a lot of technology, and I want to do a piece on that. But again, I'm kind of lazy, and because I'm lazy, you know, and other things come up, and when other things come up, then I go find another topic, and then I'm down the road somewhere else. But I do want to do something in the future where I'm going to discuss the technology of the Aboriginal Black Americans. You know what I mean? You know, a lot of the stuff, they never talk about that aspect of technology, one, because, you know, if they talked about it on TV programs, they'd have to show the people who did it, who were mainly Black. And they know a lot of Mongoloid Indians. They talk a lot of ish, and they got the card that says that they're the real Indian, but they're not the real Indians. The real Indians were Black people. They came here later. We adopted them, and they stole our heritage. stole our history and everything. You know, History of Blacks in America, you can check out my book. As I said, I revised my book, History of Blacks in America, from prehistory to 1877. There's a lot of good information here on the Aboriginal Black Americans, and also on the Black Europeans that came to America and that founded Americas, you know, because, you know, I've had a lot of people write me and say, well, my parents were Irish, you know, my parents were never slaves. And, you know, I can explain that when you look at this particular book, because in this book, I show you that how there were many Black people over here that were European. And as I said earlier, if you were a Black person from Germany, of German ancestry now, just like, you know, one of the biggest stars was who? Arnold Schwarzenegger. And what is that? That's Arnold the Black Nigger. Schwartz Black, Niger Nigger, Arnold the Black Nigger. But the point is that he's white today. But again, in a sense, that goes back to his African ancestry when the Moors, you know, ruled much of our Germany. But again, in a sense, for those people who claim that their parents that their family was never slaves, that they're of Irish or they're of Norwegian background, you know, this book explains, because see, many of the Black people after Cromwell attacked the Black Scots and the Black Irishmen, many of the Black Scots and the Black Irishmen, they immigrated to Norway. Yes. And then you also had the Sephardic Jews and also the Moors. And then a lot of these Black people came over here as crypto Sephardics or crypto Moors. And these were people who were pretending to be Christian, who weren't really Christian. They were really people who were Muslims and Hebrews, but they were Black. So again, get this book, History of Blacks in America. Again, some of the other books that can help you, of course, is History of Blacks in America. You can get the Phylogeography of Afro-Americans and Africans. In this book, I explain you our genetic heritage. And then we are not just Africans. I talk about, in a sense, the history of Black people in the Americas. I'm either going to make a new book that's going to deal with just the a lot of the information I'm going to talk that I've been talking about in the last two videos plus this video, or I might just expand. We are not just Africans and add the information and put it in there. But I'm still deciding on what I do if I live long enough. Other books that deal with Black people in the Americas is, of course, Atlantis in Mexico, where I talk about the Olmecs. Then I have African Empires in Ancient America, where I talk about all of the ancient, all the various African empires. Then I got Ancient Scripts in South America. This book is very important. And it's important because they always claim that the people in South America didn't have writing, but I show that they did. Then in my book, The Mandean Ancient America, I discuss the various Mandi outposts. And many of these Mandi outposts, they date back to the voyage of Abu Bakari from Mali to the Americas. And you got to remember that Abu Bakari, when he came to the Americas, it was 25,000. Yes, 25,000 people. And then, of course, my book, The Black Mound Builders of America, where you can find out about the Black Mound Builders. Part 3, Origin, Aboriginal Foundation of Black Americans. This is what used to be in the dictionary. In this dictionary, it said at 569, what is the third race and what are its characteristics? The American or Indian race found only in Americas, of a deep copper color, straight black hair, high cheekbones, eyes black and sucking, large faces and robust bodies. This race comprises all the American Indians except the Esquimaux, who belong to the Asiatic white race. Now these are the Indians. Now that's the real American up there at the top. But let's look at 570. What is the fourth race and what are its characteristics? The African or Negro race. They have a jet black skin, low narrow forehead, black woolly hair, thick lips, and long heels. This is all bullshit. Look at that picture. Look at that picture. Look at those two pictures. The only difference between the American and the Negro is what? Is that the American, they gave him some feathers. And they had let him wrap wrapped herself in a cloak. You know, but see, that's the way it is. You know, America's always been playing games. They've always been trying, in a sense, to rewrite history. They have to change history all the time because, see, they're constantly changing history because they have to try to hide from people the real history of the Americas. You know, Europeans use divide and rule to dominate the FBA. The Caucasians in America use divide and rule tactics to dominate FBA. Here we can see that there was no difference between African and Aboriginal Blacks. But originally they made a difference between both groups to steal the identity of the Aboriginal FBA, who they later identified as color. You know, it's very interesting that I remember when Gates of Harvard University, when he first started doing his DNA stuff, and he did a DNA test of all the people, and he said it wasn't any Indians. But then the darkest person in the study, which was Oprah Winfrey, she ended up being the only one carrying African DNA, you see. And so then he thought he was white because they found out that he carried what was called the R1 haplogroup. But as I told you earlier, the R1 haplogroup, V88, that's an African haplogroup. It's an African haplogroup. And see, the whole point is this, is that when you don't do your research, people can tell you a lie. And see, people will tell you a lie and then control you because of the fact that you failed to read the original documents. You failed to really check over what people say. But you have to be careful.
All right, my beloved. So what are some of the FBA Aboriginal tribes?
Alphonse de Quatre-Fages claimed that the Black tribes of Latin America include the Chacos, Manabis, the Yaruras, the Guaranis, the Charros, the Yamasi, and Tizendal Chantal, in addition to the numerous ethnic groups along the Orinoco River in Venezuela and the Isthmus of Darien. The major Native American confederations were made up of Black and Mongoloid Native Americans. These confederations include the Iroquois, Muscogean, and Algonquin. These were confederations. Many people think like the Iroquois, Muscogean, and Algonquin. They think that these were tribes, and they weren't tribes. What they was they were confederations, because just like in Africa, the government is usually, in a sense, made up of various different tribes, you see? And these tribes could be members of different cities, or they could be tribes that speak different languages. But what they do is that they come together to form confederations, and in these confederations, they have governments. You have to remember, in a sense, is that the American government is based upon the Iroquois and the Algonquin governmental systems. Yes, yes. They were influenced by these Black Native Americans, these Black or Aboriginal FBA people who had a governmental system that Europeans saw that was very effective, so they copied it. Because they were blood brothers, Black and Mongoloid Native Americans often shared the same names for their tribes. Of course, they shared the same names. And the reason they had the same names was mainly because of the fact, in a sense, is that these tribes were adopted by Black people. Oglethorpe returned to England in June 1734 with goodwill ambassadors in the person of the Yamacra chief, Tumuchichi Sinauki, his wife, and nephew, Tunachowi. You can see, in a sense, in that picture, you can see some of the Yamacra Indians. And you can see, in a sense, their copper color. Or, you know, when they say copper color, just another brown Negro. As the principal mediator between the native population and the New English settlers during the first years of Georgia's settlement, Tumuchichi left contributed much to the establishment of peaceful relations between the two groups and to the ultimate success of Georgia. His nephew, Tunachowi, is seated on the right in this engraving, circa 1734-1735, by John Faber, Jr. Tomochichi and six other Lower Creek tribesmen. These were some of the Yamacra and included some Creeks. Aboriginal Black tribes. Some of the Black Native American tribes were the Blackfeet, Cree, Choctaw, Costantinoan, Kashida, Lenape, Mandan, Manican, Mandinka, Nanichoke, Narragansett, Nudowesi, Niantes, Ohlone, Potawomack, Piqua, Ramapo, Shinnecock, Seneca, Seminoles, Secolan, Democrat, Tsoyaham, the Tuscaleros, the Wapanoag, or Poconoke, the Wichita, the Yamasee, the Yamacry, and Uchi. The Black Native American cultivated the three sisters. And these three sisters were what? Maize, beans, and squash. The basic organizing principle for Black Native Americans was the tribe. The Black Native American tribes would then organize themselves into confederations to meet threats from enemy Indian tribes and Europeans. These confederations were usually made up of Black people. Later, as Mongoloid people came, then they were also allowed to join the tribes. After a while, in a sense, after Europeans were able to throw many of the major Black confederations, then they would say the Mongoloids were a confederation. So you had to always understand this, is that Benjamin Franklin, he was the first European to see that they wanted to have a tether group. They wanted to have a group between Black and white people here. And what they chose to be that intermediate group that they could use in a sense to separate the people was, in a sense, the Mongoloid Indians. The reason they liked the Mongoloid Indians is because many of the Mongoloid Indians, you know, they had lighter skin. They had lighter skin, in a sense, than the Black Indians. So then, therefore, they felt that, in a sense, is that if they made it with these Mongoloid Indian squaws, they had a better chance, in the sense of dominating their genetic pool, because they know, in a sense, that that once a Black person hit that thing, you gone. For example, the Iroquois were actually not a people, but a confederation of eight Native American nations: the Cayuga, the Manichan, the Mohawk, the Nanakoke, the Seneca, the Oneida, the Onondaga, the Tuscarora. In terms of power, they were perhaps the most formidable. I repeat, in terms of power, they were perhaps the most formidable Native American group in North America, and the most representing the imaginative works of European settlers, controlling at their zenith, territory coming from Massachusetts to Ohio. Yes, yes, yes. These Black tribes, you found them all the way from Massachusetts to Ohio and Quebec and Ontario in Canada down to Kentucky. And it was even more, many more out west. And then we know that the tribes in California, even though they talk about all the Chicanos, I come from Mexico, Mexico always Chicano land, we make America. That's a damn lie. The people in California were mainly, just about mainly black Indians, Aboriginal Indians. But again, in a sense, is that Europeans paid, they used to pay a lot of money. They used to pay people money to depopulate, you know, various areas. You know, they would pay more money for a woman squad. A squaw's scalp than they would pay for a man, because they wanted the women and the kids killed, because they knew if you killed the women and you killed the kids, then therefore that tribe was done for, you know. Plus, often, if you killed a lot of one tribe's women, then members of the tribe would go and attack another tribe so they could steal their women. So Europeans had it was a method in their madness. We use iconographic evidence in addition to skeletal remains and eyewitness accounts. For example, we can see the Dallas, the Algonquin, the Powhatan, the Seneca, the Kutana flatheads, the Ashinopiki Sioux, the Navajo, the Aniunawiya, the Kiochine, the Chata, the Kickapoo, the Minokoyu, Lakota. You know, Lakota is very interesting. They're a very interesting group. And then we can see some of the other tribes on the other side. You know, we can see, in a sense, Cree, Seminole, and stuff like that. The history and present state of Virginia in four parts. This book was written by Robert Beverly. This is a very good book, and, you know, you may want to read it, because when you read this book, it tells you a lot about how the Indians lived. Because, see, very few books are going to give you real good information on the Indians. The Black Indians, and one of the reasons is because most of the vast majority of Black Indians lived either in California or on the East Coast. You know, from Canada down to Mississippi was mainly where the Black tribes lived. And if you notice, in a sense, is that when they talk about Indians on TV, they're mainly talking about the Navajo Indians and the Apache. They're mainly talking about the Indians that they fought out west. But the mass of Black Indians, in a sense, They did live in the Midwest, but they didn't live out west. And it was some among the Apache, like the Lakota. Some of them were black. And I remember that the David Imhotep. I think he had some of the Western Indian heritage. You know, the method of the Indian settlements is altogether by cohabitation. This is what he wrote. The method of the Indian settlements is altogether by cohabitation in townships from 50 to 500 families in a town. And each of these towns is commonly a kingdom. Sometimes one king has the command of several of these towns when they happen to be united in his hands by descent or conquest. But in such, the method of the Indian settlement is altogether by cohabitation in townships from 50 to 500, you know. Chapter 10. The manner the Indians have of building their houses is very slight and cheap. When they would erect a wigwam, which is the Indian name for a house, they stick saplings into the ground by one each and bend the other at the top, fasten them together by strings made of fibrous roots, the rind of trees or of the green wood of the white oak, which will rive into thongs. The smallest sort of these cabins are conical like a beehive, but the larger are built in an oblong form, and both are covered with the bark of trees, which will rive off into the great flakes. Their windows are little holes left open for the passage of the light, which in bad weather they stop with shutters of the same bark, opening the leeward windows for air and light. Their chimney, as among the true-born Irish, is a little hole in the top of the house to let out the smoke, having no sort of funnel or anything within to confine the smoke from ranging through the whole roof of the cabins. If the vent will not let it out fast enough, the fire is always made in the middle of the cabin. Their door is a pendant mat when they are near home, but when they go abroad, they barricade it with great logs of wood set against the mat, which are sufficient to keep out wild beasts. There is never more than one room in a house. Look on the right-hand side, you can see how they built their houses. It's very important that you remember that Aboriginal FBA people, they didn't live in teepees because they were not a nomadic people. Aboriginal FBA were people in the sense they built houses. They usually built in a sense a wall or a stockade around their houses, you know, for protection. When in their traveling, continuing, within their travels, they meet with any waters which are not fordable. They make canoes of birch bark by slipping in whole off the tree. In this manner, first they gash the bark quite round the tree. At the length they would have the canoe, and then slid down the length from end to end. When that is done, they with their tomahawks easily open the bark and strip it while off. Then they force it open with sticks in the middle, slope the underside of the ends, and saw them up. Which helps to keep the belly open if the birch trees happen to be small. They sow the bark of two together. So the seams they dowel with clay or mud and then pass over in these canoes by two, three, or more at a time, according as they are in bigness. By reason of the lightness of these boats, they can easily carry them over land. If they foresee that they are like to meet with any more waters that may impede their march, or else they leave them at the waterside, making no further account of them, except it to be to repass the same waters in their return. So this is how the black Indians made their canoes. These Indian writing. These Indians have no sort of letters to express their words by, but when they would communicate anything that cannot be delivered by message, they do it by a sort of hieroglyphic, or representation of birds, beasts, or other things, suing their different meanings by the various forms described and by the different positions of the figures. Their language differs very much as Antionally in the several parts of Britain, so that nations at a moderate distance do not understand one another. However, they have a sort of general language, like what Levantine calls the Algonquin, which is understood by the chief men of many nations, as Latin is in most parts of Europe, and lingua franca, quite into the through the Levant. The general language here used is said to be that of the Auchinichis, though they have been but a small nation, ever since those parts were known to the English. But in what this language may differ from that of the Algonquin Regoncadines, I am not able to determine. See, it's very important to understand, as I said, traditionally Black people have lived in communities where the Black people lived there spoke different languages. But just as noted by this particular author, is that that even though they spoke different languages, they would develop in a sense a lingua franca. And they would use this lingua franca as a means of communication among all of them, so that they would be able, in a sense, to be able to communicate in linguistically. So it's very important to understand is that this is what is the dynamicism of Black people, is that Black people are always being creative, that Black people are always making the unknown known. The king and female descent. This is chapter 26. I can't think of anything but their jealousy that makes them exclude the lineal issue from succeeding immediately to the crown. Thus, if a king have several legitimate children, listen to this. Thus, if a king have several legitimate children, the crown does not descend in a direct line to the children, but to his brother by the same mother. You hear that? That's a matrilineal descent, just like in Africa. I'm sorry to tell you out there, you brothers and sisters who think just because you belong to a Native American tribe, that you belong to an Aboriginal Black tribe, that you don't have any African ancestors, it's false. This is how your ancestors lived, my ancestors lived. I repeat, thus if a king has several legitimate children, the crown does not descend in a direct line to the children, but to his brother by the same mother. If he have any, and for one of such, to the children of his eldest sister. Always respecting the descent by the female as the sure side. But the crown goes to the male heir, if any be in equal degree, and for one of such, to the female, preferably to any male that is more distant. In other words, in a sense, they want to make sure that you have pure descent. And we know, as they say, daddy maybe. Daddy maybe, because you never know, in a sense, if that woman is having a child that is really the child of that particular father. But we always know that if that woman was a descendant of that particular leader, then therefore we knew, in a sense, that any child she bore would have, in a sense, carried the proper genetic material. Again, as when I was growing up, they always said, mama, yeah, but daddy, maybe, baby. Thomas Harriot, who accompanied White and approximately 600 colonists to Roanoke in 1585. Harriot wrote that chiefs wore aprons made of animal skin with a tail that hung down behind them between their buttocks. The tail was used in carrying a quiver of arrows. The Indians' hair adorned with feathers was shaved on the right side. Here we can see some of the Indians. You can see, in a sense, where they carried their carried their arrows, they carried their bow and arrow, and they wore an apron. See, it's very important to understand that wearing an apron goes back to Egypt, because the Egyptians, they called their apron apar, as Baba Hero would put it, apar. So in a sense, just like over in ancient Egypt, the American the Aboriginal Indians, they wore aprons, and here you can see some of the Atumacra Indians. Sometimes they like to dye their hair, but you can see how they mend themselves. He freely told me they believed in God. This is very interesting. It's a Mandean Indian chief. He freely told me they believed in God was universally beneficent, that his dwellings was in the heavens above, and that the influences of his goodness reached to the earth beneath, that he was incomprehensible in his excellence and enjoyed all possible felicity, that his duration was eternal, his perfection boundless, and that he possesses everlasting indolence, and ease. I told him I had heard that they worshiped the devil, and asked why they did not rather worship God, whom they had so high an opinion of, and who would have given them the good things and protect them from any mischief that the devils could do them. To this he answered was that 'tis true, God is the giver of all good things, but they flow naturally and promiscuously from him, that they are showered down upon all men indifferently without distinction, that God does not trouble himself with the impertinent affairs of men, nor is concerned at what they do, but leaves them to make the most of their free will and to secure as many as they can of the good things that flow from him. That therefore it was no purpose either to fear God. So think about this, see, you know, this shows you that the black Aboriginals, they already had a firm belief in God, you see. And in fact, they saw God as omnipotent. They saw God as the most powerful thing. And so the Europeans, when they try to tell you that they brought to the heathens religion, is a lie. This author right here tells you that the black Indians had a firm belief in the Creator. They had a firm belief that he gave grace and mercy to everybody, you see. But see, the European, he had to change that. He had to change that you can only get grace and mercy from the white boy on the stick. You see? The white boy on the stick.
Teach it.
People wear these crosses and they're worshiping death. Death is a cross. When you wear a cross and say that's a symbol of your religion, that means you're worshiping death, because that cross represents, in a sense, the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, Yeshua. But you can see these Indians, they knew God. Our ancestors knew God. That's why they said, what the hell, why should I be listening to these white folks? Atitulumani Khan. Historian Robert Beverly, in his History and Present State of Virginia, wrote that the Okanichi language was widely used as the lingua franca. Let's listen. I quote, it was understood by the chief men of many nations as Latin is in many parts of Europe. Even though he says the Okanichi have been but a small nation ever since those parts were known to the English, Beverly said that the priests and conjurers of the other Virginia Indian tribes performed their adorations and conjurations in this general language, much as the Catholics of all nations do their mass in Latin. Linguistic scholars believe that the Okanichi spoke a dialect of the Siouan language of the Tutelo. And see, these were the Manican. Who spoke the Manican language? That was the Mandingo people. Yes, we come again to the Mandingo people. And these were people in Virginia. Remember, we talked about the fact that the Aztecs, that they were really Muslims, that they built mosques. And I showed you the receipts from the Spanish, that they built mosques. So see, now we're finding out, in a sense, that these Indians in Virginia was using the Manican language, which they called Okanichi. Let's look at the Manican language. The Manicans of Virginia, on the Roanoke River, they mined copper and grew the three sisters, beans, corn, and squash. The Manican tribe belonged to the original Iroquois Confederacy. I say original Iroquois Confederacy because the Confederacy that they Iroquois Confederacy they think they teach, and the ones that they make, they made a couple of things I saw on YouTube about the Iroquois Confederacy. That's not their original. That's the Mongoloid Confederacy, because most of the Aboriginal Black Indians, they either killed them off or they made them slaves. Kareem Wood, a researcher, claims it belonged to the Manican language. You know, it is bullshit. Kareem Wood is a liar. She's not a Manican, because the historical evidence shows that the last Manican died in 1880. But this Mongoloid woman is going around saying that she's going to revive the Manican language. Again, like I tell you, they give the Mongoloid Indians free reign to claim they can be any Indian. But you can be an authentic descendant. For example, you know, my family, have Choctaw, but they're not going to give me a card as Clyde Winters the Choctaw. Hell no. They say you're Clyde Winters the Nigger. But anyway, what Karen Wood is doing, she's trying to compare Tutelo language. And this is supposed to be in the language spoken by the Manican. Let's look at Tutelo. In Tutelo, the word for black is Sabi. The word Mandi is Safi. For good and pure, in Tutelo, the word is Api. In Mandi is P. The father is called Ati. In Mandi, Ki is the name for man. In Tutelo, the word for dead is Tit, and the word for dead in Mandi is Tit. So as you can see, you know, the Manican, as shown by their name, they spoke a Mandi language. The Mandi have left us the following greeting, Niji. Every time you see Dane Calloway and the rest of these brothers and sisters, when they go to the powwow, they say, Niji, 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 yeah, dumbasses. You're saying Niji. That's not a damn, that's a damn African word that means hello, you fools. You want to run away from your African heritage. You can't run away. I tell you that 25,000 Mandingos came over here with Emperor Abu Bakari. That's why when you say Niji, all you're saying is the same greeting they use today. The Akanichi greeting was Niji. Ni means manifestation of life or friend, and Gi or G means male. It was a way that black Indian males would meet each other. What up, doe? Like if I see you, I say, what up, doe? They said, Niji. What up, brother? That's what they were saying. Get out of here, you dumbasses. You want to run away from your history? You can't. This is what Baron Lahontan's in his new voyage to North America, edited by Reuben Gold, the Waits, wrote. And this is what he wrote. All the savages are of a sanguine constitution, inclined to an olive color, and generally speaking, that they have good faces and proper persons. Tis a rarity. You know, that they made the S different in the old days. That's why this letter looks like an F. It's really an S, but this is how it was transposed when I put it into the on the slide. It's a great rarity to find any among them that are lame, hunchback, one-eyed, blind, or dumb. Their eyes are large and black as well as their hair. Their teeth are white like ivory, and the breath that springs from their mouth is, in expiration, is as pure as the air. Yes, your breath is as pure as the air. Don't come around me in the morning, though. Anyway, is as pure as the air that they suck in. And inspiration. Notwithstanding, they eat no bread, which shows that we are mistaken in Europe in fancying that the eating of meat without bread makes one's breath stink. You know, here's a color of person with olive skin. Oh yes, that's olive skin. You know, you look over there on the right hand side, that's olive skin. This is what Baron Lahontan was talking about. Stop it. Stop it. Stop it. Do your original research. Read. Aboriginal have the attitude toward the family, life, family, and Europeans. Again, this is from Beverly. They think it understandable that one man should have more than another. They think that not one man should have more than the other. And that the rich mode have more respect than the poor. In short, they say the name of savages, which we believe upon them, would fit ourselves better, since there is nothing in our actions that bears an appearance of wisdom, such as have been in France, where continually teasing us with the faults and disorders they observed in our towns as being occasioned by the money. In other words, in a sense, you know, Europeans are ran by money. They were ran by money back then, and they're still ran by money. Yes, Europeans will do anything for money, and sadly, many of us will do it too. It is in vain to remonstrate to them how useful the differences of property is for the support of a society. They make a jest of what's to be told, what's to be laid on the head. And find they neither quarrel or nor fight, nor slander one another. Did you hear that? Did you hear that? The Black Indians, our Aboriginal ancestors, they didn't quarrel. They didn't fight. What they had to fight? What reason did they have to fight? But look at us today. Since something has been done to us, you can't hardly find Black people get along with each other. Look at all this gang banging, all this shooting. But that's not us. That's not us. That's not your nature. That's not our nature as foundational Black Americans. We didn't always do that. Somebody taught us that. Something's been done to us.
Preach.
They brand us for slaves and call us miserable souls. Whole life is not worth having. Allegating that we degrade ourselves in subjugating ourselves to one man, one prophet, one possesses the whole power and is bound by no law but his own will. You hear that? This is what we told the white man. You ain't shit. All you think about is money. All you do is fight each other, kill each other. But sadly today, Saturday today, we've lost our history, we've lost our heritage, we've lost those things that made us human beings. And we traded it all in to be with Europeans. He said that we have continual wars among ourselves, that our children rebel against their parents, that we improvid one another and publicly promote our own destruction. That's how we saw them Europeans. We didn't want to be with them. But they wanted, in a sense, to change us. This is how we lived. I'm not talking no ish. You can go listen to Dane Calloway. You can listen to Carimio. And they can tell you all type of stuff, but they're not going to the text. They're not going back to our history. They're not trying to teach you how our ancestors, our Aboriginal ancestors lived. They didn't teach you how we believed in God. They didn't teach you how we treated our family. They teach you only what the white man tells them. That's why they have 100,000 followers. That's why people gravitate to Dane Calloway and they gravitate to Carimio because they want to hear a lie. I'm not a I'm not a bitch. And only bitches love lies. I'm sorry.
So wrong. Sorry.
That's not my daddy told me I do it. My daddy told me.
That is how the old school do it though. That's how the old school talk about it.
My dad said, if you believe a lie, you ain't nothing but a bitch. I said, what do you mean? A woman? No, he said, no, not a damn woman. Our Black women ain't no bitches, but you'll be a bitch. You'll be a dumbass dog, you foolish mother. Leave me alone.
Wow. Daddy-o. Okay.
Leave me alone, daddy.
All right.
Leave me alone,
all right.
Stop it. Stop it. Baron Love. Baron Loholden said Aboriginal FBA believed in one great God. You see, this is very important to understand. The FBA explained that the sun, this is what they always say, why did we worship the sun? Okay, I'm going to quote, believers in savages and the obstacles of their conversion. This is why he said they wouldn't join or become Christian. All the savages are convinced that there must be a God because they see nothing among material beings that fulfills necessarily and by his own nature. See, that's the whole point. See, a lot of you dummies out there, the white men have taught you that you can't see God. A lot of them have taught you that because you can't see God, you shouldn't believe. But see, our original ancestors, our Aboriginal Black people told the white man, you know, I see God every day because I see nature, everything, everything is God. They prove the excellence of a deity by the frame of the universal, which naturally leads us to a higher and omnipotent being, from whence it follows. Say they, that man was not made by chance. You weren't made by chance. And that he's the work of a being superior in will and wisdom and knowledge, which they call the great spirit or a matter of life, and which they adorn in the most abstracted and spiritual manner. They deliver their thoughts on him thus, without any satisfactory definition. Yes, yes, yes. That's why the white man can teach us ish. That's why Reverend Dr. Matthews is telling you all about Emma. God, 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 God. You hear people on Facebook, Twitter, talking about don't believe in God. We've always believed in God because that's our salvation. That's our protection. Do you think we'd still be here if the white man had his say? They would have been and wiped us out, killed us all. But they can't do it because we're the children of God. The FBA explained why the sun represented God. I quote, this is what they told Baron Lahontan. In a word, the singular medicinal of this unfortunate people consists in denying their attention to anything but what's visible and probable. This is the standing and true principle of their religion when you consider it abstractly. But if you ask them in particular why they adore God in the sun, listen now. When he asks them why they adore God in the sun rather than in a tree or a mountain, their answer is this, that they choose to admire the deity in public by pointing to the most glorious thing that nature affords. Nature affords, you dumbasses! That's why we said we worship the damn sun! We didn't worship the fucking sun!
You need your pills and sippy cup now? Is it about that time?
It's about that time. I'm listening. Hey, my sippy cup. But our people, we told them, they said, no, we don't worship no damn sun. But the sun is the most powerful thing in the sky. The sun makes the grass grow. It makes the plants grow. It makes us feel warm. And they said that we just said that it represented God. Don't you get it? Don't you get it? Don't you get it, you dumbasses? You keep looking for God to come and talk to you and say, what up, dude? But our Aboriginal ancestors, they saw God every day because they said, God is represented by the sun. Because it's the most powerful thing. And we knew the color of God. We knew he wasn't blue. We knew God was black.
That's right.
Black, you dumbasses. I'm sorry. Black Native Americans were spread from the East Coast to California and up into Canada. Much of what is now Georgia was a stronghold of the Black Native Americans. These Blacks lived predominantly from the Smoky Mountains of North Carolina southward as far as St. Augustine, Florida. The vast majority of Native Black Americans lived in California or along the eastern seaboard. They belonged to many confederations. They were Choctaw, Tuscaroras, etc. You know, many of these people were Muslims. Yeah, many of these people were Muslims, you see. I know a lot of times when you see these Arabs, and you see them, and now you see these Arabs, and they be talking to these Europeans, and they always had a little cloak, and they wrap it up. You see, these Muslims over here had the same clothes. Same clothes. Stop it. Stop it. Stop it. Then it was many California tribes. Did we see California tribes? The shoulder one on the other side, but these are natural brothers on the right side. We can see some of these various tribes. Look at those hairstyles. Black people always love black women, black men. They always love the style and profile of their hair. But these were some of our California Indian tribes. The Ogallani people, also known as the Castanoans, are of Native American people of the Central and Northern California coast. When Spanish explorers and missionaries arrived in the late 18th century, the Ohlone inhabited the area along the coast from San Francisco Bay through the Monterey Bay to the Lower Salinas Valley. All that time, they spoke a variety of languages. You know, my wife's niece, she lived in Seattle. And so when she was a little kid, she was in the basement and she saw a ghost. And so she went and told her father that she saw a ghost in the basement, a black Indian. And he called her and he said, no, it couldn't have been a black Indian. But yes, that's because black Indians lived there. But see, he wouldn't have known that because we didn't talk too much about the fact that there were black people all the way from California up to Washington State, Seattle. Yes. Here's a painting of some of these various Ohlone people. A lot of them, they lived on the missions. And when they lived on the missions, you know, a lot of times those Catholic priests worked their asses to death or poison them, all type of shit. There's all, because they wanted to take California. That's why with them talking about reparations, they owe us so much money all over the damn place. They're always killing us. Here's some more, California Indians, about 100 black tribes in California. These are some examples of some of the various California tribes. Louis Clairaut was a famous German-Russian painter and explorer. He was one of the first to make sketches of his expeditions. Louis Clairaut, who was a Russian of German stock, was born in Yakovlev, now Dnipropetrovsk, in Ukraine, on March 22, 1795. He visited the Pacific and the west coast of North America. In 1816, on board the Rurik, being attached to the capacity of artists to the Romanov expedition under the command of Lieutenant Otto von Kotzebue, sent out for the purpose of exploring a Northwest Passage. He made many of these paintings. These paintings show us how the Californians look. Do they look mongoloid to you? Hell no, because there wasn't no mongoloids there. The white man sent some mongoloids up there and said, now you this tribe, you that tribe, you this tribe, that tribe, and that's it. See, the white man always been replacing us with mongoloids. He'll kill our asses off and then tell the mongoloids, you pretend you this, you pretend you that. By the time the Buffalo soldiers fought Indians and the black fought Indians out west, the black Indians were killed off and replaced by nomadic mongoloid Indians from Mexico. Study our true history, not lies, not lies. See, this on the right hand side, you know, left hand side, this is a Buffalo soldier. That's what they called in a sense, you know, Lieutenant Sergeant James Clark. They called him a Buffalo soldier because of the black skin, the kinky hair, and he resembled a buffalo. So those mongoloids called him a buffalo soldier. But I just told you, look on the right side. He don't look no different than the damn Indians who were originally there, yes. But see, the white man made it his job to kill off all the black Indians he could find. And then he let mongoloids take our names. He let mongoloids, in a sense, he gave them reservations. He gave them cards. See, he said, fuck you. Fuck you, he said. I ain't giving you no damn card. Nigga, what? You not an Injun. You a Negro. He lied. So he could steal our history. These are some of the southern tribes. There's a Blackfoot over there on the left-hand side. See on that horse? I love this picture. This is a beautiful picture of a Blackfoot Indian. You see? Then on the other side, we see some other black Indians down south. These are some of the brothers were down there, and you can see them talking ish. One brother raised his hand, can I get a Budweiser? Or maybe you want a little bit of that Jim Daniels. In North Carolina, there were many black Native Americans, including the Uchi, the Creek, and the Yamasee. So the first picture is of a yew tree. Then we see a creek in the middle, and then there's a Yamasi on the end, you know. Here's some of the Carolina Indians. The German painter Philip George Frederick von Reck, he drew these pictures of the yew tree. These are some yew tree Indians. They had their blanket, the rifle, you know. Here's some Indians. These are our Indians that used to live in up in South Carolina. You can see them on their canoe. You can see them out there fishing. See? Yes, yes, yes. You were here. You were there. You weren't always a slave. All of us weren't slaves. You know, on my father's side, my great-great-granddaddy, Venters, he's a slave, and then my mama sat them Choctaw down. You see? When I was a kid, I didn't worry about being a Choctaw. When I found out I was a Choctaw, I said, I don't want to be no damn Choctaw. I looked at all those cowboy movies, Indians always lost. Since the Indians always lost, I only want to know about my African side. I want to know about the great kingdoms of Mali, Ghana, and Songhai. You see? But as I got older, I became even more prouder because I began to see that we not only had great civilizations in Africa, but my ancestors over here, my Aboriginal American ancestors, they made great civilizations too. Here goes some second times. And again, I showed you this picture earlier on the right, those Yamacras. But the Black Native Americans had many wars, first the Spanish and later the British colonies. These Black Native Americans lived on the Atlantic seaboard from New York all the way down into Florida. These Black Native Americans fought bravely for their lands. Some were sold into slavery into the Caribbean, while others were made slaves, identified as Negro freemen in the South. Yeah, every time they would conquer, they would, you know, after a while, they stopped really wanting to admit that Indians were Black, and that Indians, in a sense, were Indians, so they just would call them Negroes or call them colored people. But, you know, we didn't just go and give up our land easily. But the Black Native Americans had many wars, you see. You know, Black Native Americans have a history of fighting Europeans for their independence. This was especially true in North Carolina. You can see some of the various Black tribes. The Chickasaw, the Upper Creeks, Muskogeans, the Cherokee, Catawban, the Uchi, the Achichi Creeks, the Yamasi, Catawbs, and the Tuscarora. Now the Cherokee, that's a very interesting group. A lot of times the Cherokee, Europeans really liked the Mongoloid people who we adopted, and they allowed them in a sense to really become the dominant group among the Cherokee, because again, the European, he didn't want to really deal with us because he knew that over in England, you know, the royalty in England, when most of them came over, were Black. And they was going to do everything they could to make sure that Black people didn't run them over here. Black Native Americans, they fought the British. Here we can see some Black Indians who fought them. And then look on the other side, the left-hand side, we see the brothers who were fighting during the Yamasi War. And you can see some of these brothers wore turbans. Some of them wore, in a sense, kufi hats. Others just wore the red wrap around their head. You can find out more about some of the red wrap and the importance of it if you go and see the movie, Maroons, American Maroons. These Black Native Americans were made into slaves by the colonists. Some of them were even sold in slavery in the Caribbean. If you want to find out more about some of these Black Native Americans, get my book. We are not just Africans, the Black Native Americans. You know, we are not just Africans is the title of my new book, because Afro-Americans are more than descendants of Sub-Saharan Africans. This book is richly illustrated with colorful pictures of the Black Native Americans. It provides a history of Black Native Americans from 12,000 BC up to the present. Learn about the various Black Native American tribes and their culture, and how the Native American slave trade in New England and the Southeast led to the extermination and decline of Black Native Americans in the United States. They never killed us all off. I know my wife, you know, my wife, her on her father's side, her father her father's mother was Blackfeet, and his father was Cherokee. And then her mother came from Alabama. She had Indian ancestry too, but she didn't know what Indian her family came from, because she said her grandmother couldn't speak English, so she didn't know what the hell she said. She was saying, "That's what my mother-in-law said."
So, who were the first slaves in the United States?
That's a very good question. You know, Bryn began the Black Indian slavery and the American Caribbean slave trade. 4 years before the Pilgrims anchored off Massachusetts, British fishermen already started making their way through New England, storming through Indian towns to kidnap Native people for profit in the slave trade. Yes, people who don't know that the first triangular trade was a trade that involved them selling, you know, Black Indians to the Caribbean. And in fact, the funny thing I just learned a little while ago was the fact is that up until the 1830s and 40s, what they would do is that whenever they would need some more slaves, and they couldn't buy any, you know, especially after the 1700, 1800, that's when they supposedly stopped importing slaves. And so what they would do is that they would attack an Indian village, and then they would take all of the Indians who they captured, and they would put them on a boat and take the boat to Bermuda, then bring the boat back, because see, it was against the law to sell. It was against the law in Virginia, and also certain parts of South Carolina to sell Native, American Aboriginals. So what they would do is that they would just get them, put them on a boat, and take them to Bermuda and bring them back and say, "Oh, they're not really from here; they're from Bermuda." And that was a lie. They all knew it was a lie. You know how the white man play with his courts, he plays with his laws. A lot of this is bullshit. The Pequot is a Black Native American people, and they all lived in Connecticut. And these were the first tribes that we know of that they put into slavery. They sold tens of thousands of them. They were very numerous back in the day, but the British sent a lot of them to Bermuda. Those that they didn't sell to slaves in Bermuda, they put them on tobacco plantations. Yes, they put them on tobacco plantation. They grew tobacco because, see, the European, he's always been lazy. And since he's always been lazy, he's always been trying to find somebody else who could do the work for him. Let's face it, they couldn't go out in the sun back then. Come on now. How they were going to work in the sun? You know, you see how they catch cancer today. So what they do is that they would get these Black Native Americans, and they would put them on a tobacco plantation. Right here, you can see here, they got a picture, you know, and you can see that the so-called Indian was a Black man. But you go tell people today, you go try to tell somebody today that they were Black Indians, they call you a lie. But they know the truth. They know who our ancestors were. The Europeans took Black Native Americans and made them slaves. The first slaves in the United States grew tobacco and cultivated rice and indigo. Like people in Africa, Native Americans sold each other into slavery for guns and cheap goods. Yeah. That's how the European took over Africa. That's how the European took over America. He took over the same way. He found some niggas and they sold each other for some damn guns. Sold each other for some rum. Yes, 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 yes. Yeah, dummies. The whites concentrated on encouraging the Indians to fight each other so they could buy the losing tribal members as slaves. They also kidnapped Native Americans and made them slaves. Because the Black Native Americans were farmers, whites concentrated on enslaving Black Native Americans instead of Mongoloid Native Americans, who mainly lived in the southwestern United States. Yeah, they couldn't, Mongoloid Indians, they could maybe hunt, but they didn't know how to do no farming. They didn't know how to grow ish. We adopted them, and they pay us back by always putting a foot up our ass. Much of what is now Georgia was a stronghold of Native Black Americans. These Blacks lived predominantly from the Smoky Mountains in the North Carolina. The Umasi was the major tribe of Black Native Americans who originally lived in Florida and Southern Georgia until they were forced to migrate north into South Carolina by the Spanish in the 16th century. The Umasi were part of the Muscogean Confederacy. This was the Confederacy of Mongoloid and Black Native Americans. I told you before, A lot of Muskogean, the original Muskogean Confederacy, was made up mainly of Black tribes. But then as they began, in a sense, to make war on the Muskogean, then the white people told the Mongoloids, "You the Muskogean Confederation?" Or what? They said, "What? You the worm?" See, that's it. That's it. Ever since Benjamin Franklin came on the scene, Europeans have always been taking our history, taking our heritage, and giving our names to some other people, Mongoloid people, so that they could pretend that they were us. They're not us. They weren't the five civilized tribes. The five civilized tribes was you. The five civilized tribes was me. The five civilized tribes was us. But if you go to Oklahoma, now you're going to see a second frequency running the tribe. The whites began to steal the Imasi lands by 1750. The Imasi, leading a confederation of other tribes, attacked the whites to drive them off their lands. The Cherokee were part of the Muskogean Confederation, as usual, broke away and formed an alliance with the British in 1718 and helped defeat the Imasi. See what I'm saying? Every time you deal with those Mongoloid Indians, they put a foot up your ass. How you going to help them? How you going to have that black and brown coalition when they can always sell your ass out? The Imasi were not killed, were sold into slavery. Most of the Imasi fled back into their ancestral homeland in Florida, which by that time was settled by the Creek. The Imasi was virtually wiped out due to protracted wars with the Creeks, who felt they were trying to take over their land. Some Imasi joined the Seminole tribe and returned to Cherokee to control of the Imasi lands. It was all about land, baby. But just think, the Imasi, it wouldn't be no damn, maybe today, wouldn't be no Georgia ran by white folks if it wouldn't have been for those Cherokees selling us out. But this is our history. You know, foundational Black Americans have no allies. We have no allies. In the 1580s, when the English arrived in their locality, the Wampanoag occupied the coastal areas that corresponded with the boundary between today's Virginia and North Carolina. With the establishment of the first permanent English colony at Jamestown in 1607, Native American slaves began to make regular appearances in historical documents. From the 1640s up to the end of the 18th century, Max Carracci wrote extensively on Native American slaves in his article, Written Out of History, Contemporary Native American Narratives of Enslavement. He noted, Written Out of History, Contemporary Native American Narratives, and I quote, "This is especially evident from the Anglo-Indian conflicts of 1644, the Opechancanough War, and 1670s Bacon Rebellion, which reduced great numbers of Appomattox, Nansemoc, and Wayignock slaves who had been captured in what the English called just wars against coastal Algonquins. In other cases, in retaliation against quote-unquote rebel Indians, Virginia's many General Simmons decided that an entire population should be shipped to their Caribbean possessions. Deanna Beecham reports the case of the Nanciatico, a small coastal population whose last 40 surviving members were shipped to Antigua in 1705, never to be heard from again. See what I'm talking about? You see? That's why, in a sense, they got rid of a lot of Black people by selling us to Bermuda. Barbados, yes, man. Hey, man, we go there. We make it, man. Black Indian slavery. Over the period, Virginia records are silent about African Native American interactions. But by 1705, with the institution of the Black Code Laws, which restricted the rights of non-European people, indigenous Virginians appear increasingly under the labels mulatto, mestizo, and musty. Yeah, see, a lot of times, you know, just so they can make sure that they could take the land from Black people, instead of calling them being members of Indian nations, they would maybe say, "Oh no, you're not in. You're not really an Indian. You're a mulatto. Yeah, you're a mulatto. You said you're a Cherokee. You said you're a Black. You said you're a Uchi. No, you're a musty. You're a musty." They said, "Yeah, I know I'm musty, but damn, just give me some deodorant." No. They took their land. alongside ambiguous dual descriptions such as Negroid Indians. Intermixing between Africans and Native Americans was common. And court records revealed that individuals were considered Black until they could prove they were Indian. In the early 20th century, when the eugenics movement took hold at the University of Virginia, a campaign was launched to introduce racial purity that would put an end to the confusing racial classification. In fact, Deanna Beecham explained to me that the eugenicists aimed to prove that there were no Indians left in the state. Yeah, yeah. All the Indians were made Negroes. These are some of the laws that they had about the various laws that they put in effect for Indians, you see. You know. And now here's a law from 1712. And whereas the importation of Indian slaves have given our neighbor Indians in this first province some upriver of suspicions and dissatisfaction, for prevention of which for the future. That was a damn lie. I tell you what they would do is that they go in there, they'll kidnap those Indians, and then they take them in a boat to the Caribbean and bring them back. It was very hard, and it was very hard, you know, because, see, you had to prove that you were really from America, and a lot of times, you know, you couldn't find witnesses, so you would lose. You know, the European, he makes laws that can sometimes help you, but most of the laws he make can hurt you. But for some reason, we've still been able to overcome. For some reason, we've still been able, in a sense, to progress and to move forward. And that's because of the fact that we're a very adaptive people. FBA people are unique. We're very unique. We're unique because of the fact is that we always find a way to overcome. We always find a way to not only survive, but prosper. What is that old saying, you know? We don't die, we multiply, baby. Black Native Americans were not sold into slavery, had to identify themselves as, I quote unquote, free color. The same as freed African slaves. This was done by the government to make sure the Black Native Americans would lose their rights to land stolen by the whites. Since most Black Native Americans were sold into slavery or identified as free colored, they did not mix with the whites. You can find out more in my book, We're Not Just Africans. Here's some laws, again, some laws that deal with the various slaves. Here we can see an Indian sister, a Black Indian sister, and a Black Sub-Saharan African sister, both of them being sold as slaves. It didn't matter. Just because your hair was straight, what the hell did that mean? I mean, most of the women in my family had straight hair, except for my sister, but maybe that came from the dentures. I don't know. A 100,000 Aboriginal FBA was sold into slavery. Yes, yes. They sold over 100,000, probably even more than that. They didn't really count them. That is, anytime they found some Black Indians, they just sold them, you know. The French enslaved Native Americans around the Great Lakes, Minnesota, Missouri country, and Louisiana. The Europeans also needed labor to work the fields. The Americans provided the Native Americans with guns and cheap goods to purchase other Native American Indian slaves. Between 1670 and 1720, many Black Native Americans were enslaved. The Black Native Americans were sold in slavery throughout the 13 colonies, Canada, and the British West Indies. The majority of Black Native Americans sold in slavery by white and Indian slave traders were the Choctaw and Yamasee and other Carolina tribes. And, you know, because remember, originally it was the tribes up in the colonies like Massachusetts, New York, and places like that. But as they kind of got rid of a lot of slaves, a lot of Black Indians up there, they mainly had to concentrate down around North Carolina, Virginia, Maryland, where there were still some slaves, but in very large numbers. I mean, Black Native Americans in large numbers who they could make into slaves. At first, the Europeans identified the Black Native Americans as Indians. But over time, because the Carolina Indians were predominantly Negroes or Blacks, both African and Black Native American slaves were called Negroes, especially after the Yamasee War. Whites used bureaucratic erasure to take away the history and land of the Black Native Americans. Black Native Americans who did not migrate to Indian territory or sold into slavery were forced to declare on government records and census that they were free color. This was bureaucratic erasure. because Black Native Americans were listed as free colored people, just like Black Europeans and freed slaves, instead of Indians or Native Americans. Today, many Black Native Americans are fighting to get their land rights back. The legacy of Black Native Americans is seen in the genes of Native Americans. Today, most Native Americans carry R1, Black Native Americans, that is, carry R1 M173. The pristine form of this haplogroup is found in Africa. Here we can see, here's most Native Americans carry R1, here you can see. RM17, 1.5%, RP25, 23%, RM269, 21%. RM173, 73%, yes. 73% of the Black Native Americans and even some of the Mongoloids carry RM173, that's our gene, baby. It's a Black gene. That's why, in a sense, they do not allow you to go to court and use genetics to prove that you're a Native American. They do not allow you to go to court and prove you're Native American using genes, because the fact is that most of the Native Americans today, Mongoloid and the white Native Americans, they don't carry any Indian genes.
So, good beloved, what are some of the contemporary FBA tribes then?
The Lenape, Nanako, Ramapo tribes, Tuscarian, Shinnecock, Narragansetts, Yamasee, all these tribes faced decades worth of federal delay because they were Black. Even after state recognition, there are books and books written on how they were treated because their hair, skin, and features. They don't consider them as being Indians, and they have no records of coming from slaves or escaped Africans or recently arrived Africans. They are indigenous, and they keep looking at the whole group. In other words, in a sense, even though they can prove that they were never slaves, they can prove, in a sense, their ownership or their former presence in an area, they still try to deny them as being Native Americans. The Tosiyaho or Uchi are not well represented in the history books. This is for several reasons. First, while the Uchi were a large and powerful tribe, according to reports of the DeSoto expedition, evidence indicates that disease epidemics ravaged the Uchi after the Spanish men visited the East Tennessee area. The Uchi were known to have widely scattered villages that ranged from Florida to Illinois and from the Carolina coast to the Mississippi River. Legend has it that the tribe split in half over politics, and the fate of remaining half is not known. This actually seems to have happened several times over the past as portions of the tribe were absorbed into the Shawnee, the Lenape, the Cherokee, and the Cree. Here's some pictures of the Uchi. There you can see some of the pictures of the old Uchi, and on the far right, we see some of the contemporary Uchi. They still around. The Nanako, Galenia, Lenape, they also, in a sense, we know that that many other Nanako, here's a picture of the Nanako, and their words for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. You can see that their words, the original Nanako, their words for their number system, they were Mandingo words, yeah. Mandingo words. And yet today, these Nanakoke, they tell you, I got no African blood. I'm one of those Mundakoi Indians over there. I'm a Mongol. I'm like them folk. You're not like them, you dumbass. Study history instead of listening to all this bullshit they give. It is important to remember that foundational Black Americans are an exceptional people. The FBA people of the United States are the descendants of Black Native Americans and former chattel slaves. We are the oldest living ethnic group in the history of the United States. This results from the fact that our foundational Black American ancestors have lived in the United States prior to the founding of the United States and writing of the United States Constitution. We've been here. Noble Drew Ali, founder of the Moorish Scientists, continued the tradition of wearing Moorish military garb going back to the colonial period. On the left-hand side, you can see Noble Drew Ali. Look at his outfit. And then on the right-hand side, you can see one of the soldiers fighting in the Yamasi War. And look, they're wearing almost the exact same type of outfit. Look at that turban worn by Noble Drew Ali. And this is 200 years after the Yamasi Wars. You see that turban? In his turban, he's got feathers. In the turban of the Yamasi brother, he's got feathers. See how he's got that little short coat that came down to his knees, and then we see the Yamasi had the same short coat. This is what's called, in a sense, cultural continuity. Second frequency tried to tell you that we lost our culture. We lost our history. We lost knowledge of self, and that's a lie. Right? It shows you it's a lie. Many Eastern Seaboard Native Americans spoke the Mandi language, like the Nanako. Sequoia used the Divine Script to invent Cherokee writing. He had the Cherokee writing number Divine Script. And look at him. You can tell the Muslim influence on Sequoia. Look at that turban he wore. Look at that outfit. Yes, yes. See, as I told you, when Abu Bakari came here from Mali, it was 25,000 people that came with him. They spread all over the place. That's why today you find a lot of the people on the Eastern Seaboard where the Manican used to live and the Nanako, they be saying when they greet each other, they say Niji. 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 That's a Mandi greeting. But I say, what up, though? In summary, Aboriginal foundational Black Americans have a great history. These Blacks were the first people in the United States. Let's review the evidence. If you are Black, Negro, et cetera, and lived in America as an FBA, you have an African ancestry, even though your recent ancestors were not chattel slaves. This only means that one of your recent ancestors didn't come from Africa during the Atlantic slave trade. But free colored was the official name for Aboriginal Black Indians in the United States. This was a name given them by the European settlers to make sure that they didn't have their own history. Although you may not have a recent ancestor that goes back to the Atlantic slave trade, you still have African ancestry. The original North American population that lived in North America 100,000 years ago came from Africa, according to Nida Guidon. In addition, sites dating between 25,000 and 13,000 years ago, named the offshore Sinmar site, the Metalcraft Rock Shelter in Pennsylvania, the Oyster Cove in the Chesapeake Bay, the Cactus Hills in Virginia, and the Miles Point site used Southern Salutrian tools. Salutrian tool kit used in the United States comes from Africa. As a result, unless you can prove that your ancestors came from outer space, you have African ancestry. Crypto-Hebrews and Moors have African ancestry. Now, if you claim you are a crypto-Sephardic Hebrew or Sephardic or crypto-Moor, your ancestors came from Moorish Spain. Both of these groups came to Iberia from Africa, beginning with the Sanhedrin Berbers of Senegal in AD 711. The Iberian Hebrews came from Africa. They had fled to West and North Africa after the Hebrews were defeated by the Assyrians, and most Hebrews were taken into captivity in Assyria. Yeah. So if you claim you got crypto-Hebrew heritage, or you're a crypto-Moor, you still got African ancestry, nigga. What? Stop it. Stop this bullshit. Unique musical forms of Aboriginal Indians. You know, some people will tell you, often many, many, many Black musicians, our music has a little bit different rhythm than some of the music played in Africa. And the reason that our music has a little different a different rhythm, a different count, comes from the fact that our music is unique because our music is from the Aboriginal and crypto-Moorish Hebrews who settled in America. Thus, the percussion, string, wood, and brass musical instruments used today are of African origin. These instruments were taken to Europe or invented by African Moors and Aboriginals, although the rhythms and beat may be different. Yeah, you know, they always, whenever they show the Mongoloid Indians, the only instrument they got is a drum. maybe a flute. Oh yeah, my yeah, yo my yo yeah, my yeah, nigger ain't she, yeah. Oh yeah, my yeah,
Peter. All right, that's it. It's time to get your pajamas. Okay, get your little footy pajamas. Get your footy pajamas on and your medications. Let's go to bed. It's sleepy night time. He done went over the hour, family. He done went over the hour. Go ahead. You ain't got no damn sense.
Terminated. Others were forced into slavery between 1670 and 1720. 100,000 Native Americans were sold into slavery in the Caribbean. In reality, Aboriginal refugees have not went anywhere. They remained in their homelands in the North and South. But Europeans took their identities and gave them to Mongoloid Indians. Black Native Americans began to be identified as slave Indian, freeman, and finally colored. As a result of bureaucratic erasure in the public records, the former Black Native Americans simply became identified as colored, like the former Sub-Saharan Africans. In summary, we were slaves. Now we're not. Here's some references that deal with my slides so you can find out more. Go to my Patreon to see the slides. Don't forget to go to YouTube to see my videos, order my books at Amazon.com. The main books, if you want to know about Blacks in Ancient America, get David and Hoteps, The First Americans Were Africans, my book, The Mandean Ancient America, and African Empires. Here's some other books. And then you can get my new book called Pathfinder. And in my new book, Pathfinder, I talk about how I became a researcher and what led to me becoming the researcher I am today. Again, you can check out much in Aboriginal history. Thank you.
That was absolutely phenomenal. As always, that was a lot of content, though. That was a lot of content to go through.
Yeah.
And like I said, it took three times. It took, you know, three layers. But now we have the unequivocal understanding of everything Native American, quote unquote, everything Native American. We've got it now.
Yeah.
And all the migrations.
Yeah, and we have a great history, but the only problem is, again, as I said, Dane Calloway, he thought he was doing something slick when he started hearing the Napi saying Niji. So Dane Calloway said, hey, Niji, niggas ain't got Niji. We got that too, Dane. I'm sorry. Niji is African too. You cannot run away from your African heritage.
Right, right.
Your African ancestry. We were the first ones here. You know, a lot of my brothers and sisters who still continue to belong to a Native American tribe, they always want to find some type of separate identity. You can't run away from your Africanness.
That's right.
You can't run away from it. You can't run away from it. And we always trying to run away. We always trying to separate ourselves because we many of us have such an inferiority complex because of what second frequency has done to us.
Mm-hmm,
we run away from our true history. We run away from our true expressions of who we are.
Absolutely.
And we got through it in 2 hours.
That was pretty good. That was good, Doc. I mean, the family is spent, boy. They, you know, we sweating over here. This was really, really good.
Yeah. Go ahead.
I was going to say, let's give thanks and honks, but go ahead. What were you going to say?
I was going to say is that probably beginning in June, I'm going to talk about our the Aboriginal blacks that came from Europe, and I'm going to try to do that in one show. Again, next week we won't have a show, but make sure you try to find Reverend Matthews. He's going to be doing something on the African Liberation, right?
Yeah, African Liberation Day. I'll be with Sister Shanice and the African Liberation a group. They're absolutely phenomenal. I'm trying to think. Put in African Liberation in your phone, and all of it will pop up. And shout out to Amra, who I think was responsible for getting me, you know, booked on this amazing event that happens every year with thousands. Oh, there it is. Sister Shanice, can you put in the chat, if you could, the information on what we're doing, the African Liberation Day next week? If you could put that in the chat, if there's a link or something, that would be phenomenal. But yeah, that's what we're doing next Thursday. So I'm really looking forward to it and looking forward to meeting new family members around the world.
Yeah, and And I might do a live next week, but if I do a live, I'll put it on my YouTube page, and I'll let my Patreon people know. And so then, but again, like I said, is that this is it's wonderful. I'm glad I finally got through with the Aboriginal FBA. Three shows, but it's done, baby.
Now you can put it. You can now flush it out of your system. If you are you going to put this in another book, a new book, some upcoming research?
If I ever get around to writing the technology aspects of it, I want to do a thing on technology, but there's a couple other books I got to find. I really enjoyed the fact that I found the work of Beverly and Lohagan. And these people, they lived among the Indians for years. And see, when they're talking about the Indians, they lived among the Indians from New York down to Virginia. Mm. They're talking about these Indians, like their belief in God, why they said that the sun represented God. They didn't really worship the sun, but the sun worshiped God. They expressed to these people that their God wasn't like the white man God. The white man God was a God of money and disobedient children and all that type of shit. And so, so that's why I wanted to present this, so that I could provide my people an accurate account of our Aboriginal history. What they teach you on these TV programs and all that bullshit, that's because they want to try to cater to the mongoloids. That has nothing to do with you. That has nothing to do with you. See, that's why you've come here to get the truth. You come here to get reality. And that's what it's all about, is knowing who you are. And you learn about who you are by doing your research and by talking and communicating with each other. See, you lose when you don't talk to each other. You lose when you don't communicate. That's one of the reasons why Black men and women can't get along with each other, is because of the fact that we won't listen, and we fail to sense to respect each other. So you got to respect each other. I showed you how they said that even to be a king over here, you had to be a king based upon matrilineal descent, just like in Africa. Brothers, sisters, stop believing that stuff that Dane Calloway tell you about it. And stop listening to that Carimio talking about that America is the old world. No. America is the new world. America is a place where Black people build a great and wonderful civilization. Yeah, the white man, he hides our civilization. He hides the great things we've done. But see, because of the fact that he knows that we can always access. Go ahead.
I'm just putting it up. Thank you, Yoshima. He found it. And so did she. I just realized she put it up there, too. There we go. I didn't even see it. Thanks, Yoshi. Thanks, Sister Shanice. African Liberation Day next Thursday. And it's going to be on PACM Live YouTube. 6 p.m., 6 to 8 p.m. GMT, which is 10 a.m. To 12 noon Pacific. So be there or be square. It's an international affair. Everyone is welcome. And I think there's going to be both a physical and a digital component with this. So it's going to be quite exciting.
And see, and the beauty of it, family, is that we got two of our own. We got two of our own representing. And that's going to be Reverend Dr. Matthews and also
Sister Shanice. Yep.
You know, those are family members that's spreading the knowledge, spreading the power. You see? Do you see how we started off as just a little small group of people? and yet look today. how we're expanding across the world, how we're sharing with each other.
Sure.
The love of history, the love of our true history. You see?
Absolutely. Well, you know, the other part of that, Doc, is that a good part of that responsibility or accountability falls on you, teaching us how to do advanced research. Changed my life, changed Sister Shanice's life. She produced seminal work in her book, King Ofa, as a result of graduating from your research class. And so now she's as the kids would say, she's a problem. She's dangerous, man. She is dangerous. She's going to be a problem.
Wow. Denise, this is an honor.
Don't let that smile fool you, man. She will research the best of them. So, I'm looking forward to the next round of scholars that you're going to be producing from your research scholarship group. And, you know, we'll start having conversations about that and dates and what have you. So, you know, the proof is in the pudding. We've been out here now for a couple of years, and we have demonstrated the efficacy of doing primary research. And now we're able to offer people, if you want a career in this, or if you just want to be the unequivocal expert in the room, at the table, in your family, you will have a legitimate process on how to do that. So you can be able to differentiate between a Dane Calloway or a non-researcher versus a real researcher. And you learn how to research and read these papers and read between the lines and know when they're lying to you. That's what I think is phenomenal about what you brought to the table to the community.
Yeah. And again, it's wonderful. I'm happy to be with family. I'm happy to be here with you guys every week. It doesn't matter if only 10 people are here or 100,000. The fact is that you're here.
Yeah.
And you're sharing this with your families, and you're tweeting it out. You know, give a like to the video. You know, send it out. You know, go to Sister Shanice's channel. I got four videos on the Swarthy Nerds. They've done four videos of me, and they've done a couple of Dr. Short. You know, get more information, get more knowledge, invigorate yourself. You know, see, the more you be around positivity, the more you can fight this epidemic of white supremacy. You see, you know, as Reverend Matthews always said, it's what's been done to us. It's not what you did to yourself. It's what's been done to us. And the only way we can solve that is by being around positivity, thinking about who and what you are, and moving forward.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I appreciate that. All right, my family. One more thing.
Go to Yoshima's channel on YouTube and go to Spotify. You got to get that music from the genius.
From the genius himself.
From the genius.
Houston has a problem. That man is a gift. He is so talented. It's ridiculous. Indescribable, undescribable, but undeniable is Yoshi Mod. The best of the best family is who we are. It's what I have come to scientifically know, not just from the perspective of self-esteem or trying to feel better about myself, but I realized when I was going through this journey and the research and the interviews all these, you know, last 15, 20 years, is that I've come to the unequivocal reality that we are gods and goddesses in expression. We are almas in expression, in full expression, and we are grateful that we have scholars that can give us our right mind back and give us our history back and put it in the right chronology and put it in the right context and the right framework. So I want to give angst and thanks to Amma and the ancestors for Dr. Clyde Winters. And I also want to give thanks to all of you, because without you, there would be no us. Who would we talk to every week? Who would we comment to and email with every week? Because we wanted to know that this is working, and you're letting us know that it works if you work it. And we are doing so in the name of Amma. And we say, I am one with first frequency.
I am one with first frequency.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the only one.
I am one with the only one.
Ashe.
Ashe.
And so it is.
And so it is.
Thank you, beloved family. Dr. Winters, you are the GOAT. We love